In the long, behind the long hair.
From Rent, we just left.
Bem-vindos à Cinemateca Caio. Brasileira. Algumas Caio. Recomendações importantes. Desliguem celulares Caio. E quaisquer outros aparelhos que possam emitir ruído. Por motivos de segurança, lembramos que é proibido fumar e entrar na sala com comida, latas e garrafas. Os corredores foram projetados para perfeita circulação. Extintores de incêndio estão estrategicamente localizados e sinalizados. E a brigada de incêndio está pronta para orientá-los. Em caso de incêndio ou falta de energia, luzes de emergência irão se acender automaticamente. Assim, é só manter a calma e dirigir-se à saída de emergência mais próxima. Para abrir a porta, basta empurrar a barra, filmar ou fotografar, somente com autorização prévia. Boa sessão!
Boa tarde, bem-vindo àqueles que não estavam. Bom, vamos começar a terceira mesa do dia, uma apresentação da Canon. Eu vou chamar depois a Roberta, que vai apresentar o nosso convidado internacional, que veio só para essa mesa. Queria só fazer algumas observações, que, por favor, na hora das perguntas, façam perguntas no microfone, principalmente agora com tradução simultânea. Não dá para ele repetir a pergunta de vocês, então façam a pergunta no microfone, que senão não vai dar para quem está em casa depois assistindo, ver. Lembrar que, no final, nós vamos sortear um livro do Fernando Duarte, que é um grande diretor de fotografia, O Segredo da Luz Tropical. E avisar também que lá fora tem um estande da Lumatec, que eles vão sortear no final do evento uma mochila, então quem tiver interesse de ir lá visitar o stand, a preencher um cadastro e eles vão sortear, e que hoje, no final do dia, nós vamos ter um churrasco oferecido pela Red. Tá bom? Então eu vou chamar ao palco a Roberta Tenenbaum, que é da Canon do Brasil, que vai apresentar o brand, tá bem? Roberta.
Alô?
Tá.
Então, a gente agradece o Brent, de novo, segundo ano que o Brent vem para o Prêmio ABC. Fiz uma colinha e a gente ficou muito feliz, apesar do short notice, e obrigada por ter aceitado. O Brent, a gente estava na agência, né, Vitor, pensando no nome da palestra, a redatora estava quebrando a cabeça. E daí a gente fez de Las Vegas para o mundo, para falar das novidades da NAB, que o Brent encabeçou toda essa apresentação em Las Vegas. E daí, poxa, tinha que ser do Texas para o mundo, porque a gente está aqui, o Brent é do Texas. Ano passado ele contou um pouco a história dele, que é bem interessante. Eu vou tentar resumir. Então, a gente tem 40 anos de uma carreira muito bem-sucedida em produções de vídeo e filme, e HD, e, enfim, pegou 40 anos de muita transformação de mercado, também é como cameraman, diretor. Até hoje, o Brent é membro da IATSE Local 600, que é a International Cinematographers Guild, que é uma coisa bem bacana e importante, como diretor de fotografia. São inúmeros comerciais e programações de todos os tipos e formatos, e ele acabou se especializando na publicidade de carros, especialmente em sequências de perseguição automotiva. É uma curiosidade. Viajou o mundo para filmar, então, Ásia, Europa, África, Canadá, Nova Zelândia, América do Sul, Caribe, acho que é isso. E a maioria, quase todos os estados dos Estados Unidos, e ainda, entre os muitos prêmios, tem 2 Clios e 2 MBAs. Em 2012, a Canon convida o Brent para se juntar à equipe de desenvolvimento de produto. Ele é um technical advisor E ele é um dos poucos eleitos para fazer a interface com o mercado, com os fotógrafos, com quem está no mercado, com os realizadores em geral. Isso é uma coisa bem legal de trabalhar na Canon, que a engenharia está muito perto dos realizadores. E essas figuras, por isso que a gente pediu que ele viesse para falar com vocês, para escutar, acho que bastante escutar, né? Acho que é um trabalho difícil, mas para poder, enfim, representar essa interface, né? Então, ele fala um pouco, mas ele escuta bastante. Então, quem quiser, ele vai estar os 3 dias lá no nosso stand. A gente trouxe muita coisa interessante também, mais da linha de cinema, que a Canon lança em 2012, essa parte eu esqueci, e que são 4 anos muito bem-sucedidos. E estamos com 2 especialistas de produto, fora o Brent. Amanhã e depois tem os serviços de clean and check. A Canon tem assistência técnica própria na Avenida do Café, na Vila Guarani, 277. E esqueci alguma coisa, Yuri? Acho que é isso. O Yuri também cuida comigo da linha de cinema.
Legal falar que compra a limpeza pelo site.
Sim, obrigada. Ano passado a gente foi a última vez que a gente fez gratuito. Esse ano a gente vai, tem um pagamento simbólico para cobrir os custos. É um valor bem promocional, que é o Clean and Check, que é a limpeza e verificação das câmeras EOS, as câmeras de cinema, quem já tem. E quem tem a C100 e a C300 é o update do upgrade do Dual Pixel, que é uma tecnologia, o Brent vai falar um pouquinho, bastante. Em 2014, a Canon lança, e para todo mundo que faz documentário, que faz One Man Operation, que tem uma equipe reduzida, o Dual Pixel, ele é de grande valia nas horas que a gente precisa de foco. Daí, era 2 mil com dólar, não sei quanto está hoje, mas é 1.300 o preço promocional. E quem conhece alguém que tem, quer me dar o contato, ligo, explico. A ideia é que a gente montou toda uma estrutura que precisa para fazer essa atualização, e vale a pena. Os japoneses autorizaram, e a gente quer mostrar que valeu a pena. Então, quem tiver câmera sem dual pixel, passa lá. Brent, your stage. Obrigada.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Roberta. Thanks for that nice introduction. And thanks very much, Saman ABC, for having me back my second year. I'm so happy to be here. I love Sao Paulo, and it's so nice to see you guys here. They probably could have gotten another guy that knows more about a lot of the things I'm going to talk about. They won't find anyone that cares as much. I guarantee you, I am one of you guys out there. Some of you cinematographers, you filmmakers, I'm exactly like you are. And now at Canon, what I'm doing as I go forward is I am taking this on these last 4 years that I've been with Canon as the extension of my education of digital cinematography. And you might say that it's like a PhD, it's like a doctorate of cinematography, and I am one day planning to use what I'm learning today back and make more films like you guys are doing. So we're going to continue, and I'm going to have a great program in line for you. It's some boring stuff, some exciting stuff. Some of the stuff you probably already know, some of it you don't know. But let me get right into it and just show you what we got going. I'm going to show you some films, all right? So everybody needs to see some films. Let's start with a film, in fact. This is the Sundance 2016 showreel. You're going to love it. Let's go. Uh-oh. And it would have been better with sound, wouldn't it? Did we not plan on this, guys, to have sound? Otherwise, I may just cut this. It's cool anyway, so, images.
The 5D. 5D, it's cool.
I think the... if you were up here with me, you could hear them talking. It's all in English anyway, so enjoy the images. You want to
first short with the Canon 5D Mark II called Reverie. That camera's a really important part of cinema history. The 1080p video capture made a huge difference to people because that was something they didn't use the cameras to do.
That was a breakthrough camera. That's the camera that proved you could get a great image from a very small body.
You have to be able to mount, you know, the 5Ds on the DAT.
Let me start it over. I'm going to do something I never do, and that's start over. Thank you. Thank you for having me here. Let's go back. Hey, remember this slide? This is where I talked about myself. And I forgot to do one thing. I want to thank Roberta and Yuri, who are without adult supervision this week. Their boss, Osawa-san, is on vacation, so if they seem extra happy, I think that I know part of the reason. But I miss Osawa-san. He's a great guy. He brought me here. He approved this trip, so I thank him for letting me have the chance to show you this film that includes sound. Let's see if it does. Here we go, guys. Ready, sound booth? You ready? All right. Another fail. We'll go back to that, huh? Let's move on with the program. That was a good test. We know what we have. We're going to work this out. Here's what I'm here to talk to you about. This year at NAB, we didn't come out with any like crazy exciting new cameras. We came out with a couple of new products that I think are going to be extremely interesting and very, very useful for the market. And then we came out with a host of firmware updates, and I know a bunch of you guys out there have been shooting with our cameras, and if you've been shooting with the C300 Mark II especially, you've encountered some image enhancement issues, some image issues that we need to address with you, and I want to talk straight up with you, and I want to be very, very straightforward, and we're going to solve this. In fact, our engineers have done nothing but work on this camera and its processing for the last few months. And we also have new updates coming in the summer and more updates after that in the fall. So just you have to stay in touch with that. Here's what I'm going to actually talk to you about today. We attempted to show you the Canon showreel. We have another one. We'll have another chance to show another showreel in a second. And we're going to talk about these new products, the ME200 SSH, the ME20 SH, the compact servo, beautiful new lens, a brand new lens category, 18 to 80 mil T44, the firmware upgrades for the summer, and the Canon Log 2 image improvements, and the Canon Log 3 has been added as a new gamma. We'll get into some of that. And we have, I promise, more videos and clips, so you don't have to look at all my boring PowerPoints all day long. But let's get into it. Let me ask the sound men. Sound guys, are we good to go forward with videos? Are we? Yeah, we're good for sound, right? All right. How about house lights?
Myself and the driver as we're talking, and it looks fantastic. It looks like you're watching, you know, some kind of cop show. I must have a very good looking cop show.
So how would it weird you out giving you that gift?
Can we talk about this later?
Of course. Is now or later?
The entire show. show was shot on a 5D Mark II. The first network show ever shot on DSLRs. It made everybody, I think, wake up at that point saying, oh my goodness, if House can be shot on a 5D Mark II, then I can be a filmmaker tomorrow.
City of Gold had been shooting for, you know, a few years before I came out. And then when I came out, I brought my 5D Mark III. Immediately, everyone had to shoot with their camera. It's amazing to just be able to have what's in my head translate to an image on a screen.
Nice to meet you, Ryan. Welcome to Hollywood. I really believe these new tools that Canon has created allow for a much closer and more intimate relationship between the filmmakers and the world they're filming than ever before.
Canon has started with this DSLR series, and now they realize as their tools have been used by bigger budget shows and more professional type filmmakers, they began to develop tools for them as well.
It's a completely natural progression. The C300 and the C300 Mark II now are, they're obvious extensions of that technology that Canon started with the 5D.
I love shooting with the 5D, and on this movie, we wanted to move up, see what Canon had to offer, and we shot with the C300.
We shot digital, and I never want to shoot film again. I love the creative feedback of looking and knowing that this is what I want, and nobody is going to interfere with that after the fact.
No. One thing about Homeland is we're always talking about whose point of view is this, and what character's point of view are we telling this part of the story from. A lot of times, the 1DC and the 5D are the only way we can really get into these characters' heads and be in that moment.
Audience inside the race car to embed that viewer.
Oh, that's good!
I come from a film background, and for me what was important working with the digital camera was to be able to see on set an image that represents what a print would look like. I thought it looked beautiful.
When I was shooting Transparent, there'd be many times when Jill would call cut and I would see something, an actor in a certain position. They were still in the energy or feeling of the scene, and I would grab it. And that would only be possible with the lower profile, sweet little size of the C500.
Just have to step back far enough, and you will see.
Having the C300 was amazing. I needed to be able to crawl into tiny spaces. I needed to be able to shoot in cars, jump out of cars, hike up mountains. But I just love how small it was, and that really helped make the film and the shooting so much more dynamic.
No me porque saber con quién trabajas.
If you have something in your head and you're able to create that, that's the success. The Canon cameras gave me that first taste of that. That's when I felt like I was starting to become a storyteller.
It's so important for the technology to serve a story. The type of filmmaker I am, I want to be ready to go. I want to be able to be fast. I don't want to sacrifice image quality. I want it all.
Okay, awesome, awesome. Never skip the credits, right? Here we go. So, right, moving right along, let's look at these new products. I'm going to first start with this compact camera here, but we're also going to talk about this new lens that really was the hit of NAB. There weren't a lot of new cameras this year. There were some nice new lenses, a few, but this one seemed to make a big impact on everyone who saw it, and I am going to recommend it without having shot with it, but only for 2 days, and I'm like, this is the camera everyone's been asking for. We got it. So let's start, though, with this film, which is the NAB showreel, and we'll be right back to it.
You just feel superhuman, like you could do anything. That is so cool. All right. So yeah, in the previous film, you know, we started about talking about starting with the 5D Mark II, right? And that was 2008. Well, the Cinema EOS, of course, didn't even happen until 2012. Here we are in 2016, and all of that has happened, you know, and that's just last year. The Canon brand has come a long way from just an HD SLR. We're making major motion picture cameras, and and great lenses, and that's what this video is all about. And I hope that today we can I can give you a little taste of that. So let's start with this multi-purpose camera, the ME200SSH. Now I have to admit, when they told me I was going to have to introduce this to the NAB this year and I, on stage and in front of people like today, I was a little bit apprehensive because I was like, well, you know, it's not very, what? You know, it's what? You know, let's talk about it. What are we going to do with it? Well, then I got to thinking about it and I was looking on the internet. I was trying to get some help on what to talk about and I ran across this web page and it was perfect. It got my mind exactly right. And I've tried to provide with the help of my crack translation team in the Canon booth, the similar translation there, but it was like a cry for help on the internet. Can anyone tell us what this camera is for? Here it is. He put little question marks on it. It was kind of crazy, but he didn't stop there. He went into it a little bit further, and he goes, and he said, Canon has announced this really funny, boring camera, right? And it's just in time for NAB, and who thought of the name, right? That's, well, you know, the name, and let me just flip over to the translation of it in case my team did a great job of translating it. But the name I'll give him, it's not the greatest name either, but it means something. This M right here, ME, stands for multi-environment. The 200 is the model name. The S is the Super 35. The S is for SDI contacts and outputs, and the H is for HDMI. So it's not just a bunch of random names and letters, and it's actually a meaningful name, and this is the second of a series of cameras. But I took issue with him calling it boring, because it's, believe me, it's going to be anything but boring. This is a camera that you can take and put it in the environment, the multi-environment that works for you. How about underwater, or how about time lapse on the edge of a, or video images from the edge of a volcano? Or in your drone, it's meant to be encased. It has contacts to encase it and use it in photography like we haven't done before. It's very light, very small. It's going to be able to produce dramatic images, and especially this ME200, which is in fact a C100 Mark II in a box, is going to deliver very high quality HD images, and that's what it's all about, and that's really what this camera is designed for. Here's James Cameron's new vessel. I'm just begging everyone to get him the camera and put it in this vehicle, because some of these cameras are meant to go places where people can't, to be encased in items that can traverse underneath the water. And what about the time when the oil well exploded in the Gulf of Mexico, and what fixed it? Well, it was robots with cameras, you know? And so we have cameras now that can go into tight places in small packages and fix things and look at things and see in the dark. And this is going to be a very important story coming forward in filmmaking, is how can you use a camera like this? How can you invent the shot for broadcast or film production that's going to make this camera very important to your producer and your director? Here's the, of course, this is where we kind of see the initial onslaught of this camera going, is border security. And, you know, we're all kind of worried about this guy, Mr. Donald Trump, you know, that's running for president. So I think one day you may see the ME200 SSH like dotting the border. We don't, you know, this is going to be crazy, but this is what, you know, this is the possibility. But certainly surveillance and border patrol, security of any kind, this camera is meant to be encased, housed, enclosed, system built. Build a system around it, right? And this guy here, you know, he had a good idea, but, you know, he could use a little longer cable, man. I don't know what these guys are thinking, but, you know, we do make longer cables. You can run these RCV100 remote controllers from several hundred feet away with a link cable and from several thousand feet away with a fiber optic connection. So he needs to be here right now, and I could tell him, back up, man. We can get shots of animals, right? Wildlife. This is huge for it. We can nail it to a tree and encase it somewhere, even grab a shot of the elusive Cuchicabra, right? These are the kinds of things it can do. Get the IR working, go crazy, make your producer happy. All right, so let's move on. Let's look at it. So we're going to talk a little bit about both of them. This camera, the ME20FSH, they look identical. And when we shot the video for it, I think all we did was change the logo. They look identical, but they have radically different features. Very, very fine features. The ME20FS, this F here stands for full frame, right? So it's like a 1DX. what is the multi-purpose camera? This is essentially what it is. It's comprised in three modules. And the first module includes the EF Cinema Lock mount and the sensor. And in the case of the ME20F, that is a 35 millimeter full frame CMOS sensor. And in the case of the ME200, that is the C100 Mark II, same sensor, Super 35 with dual pixel CMOS, exactly the same as that camera. The main circuit board is on both of them, exactly the same as the C100 Mark II. And here's the external module. The final module out here is the external interface module, which includes three 3G SDI times two, HDMI, and remote control connections. I'll show you better pictures of all this, of course. But let's look at the comparison. Right away, you see with the higher image quality we're getting from the ME200, it's getting 1,000 TV lines. And we've bumped the sensitivity of this camera up a full stop from the C100 Mark II. So that's 204,800 for that. But this bad boy over here uses this full frame sensor. And this is that guy that goes to ISO 4,560,000. And that's not to play with, man. That is a big C in the dark. I keep reminded of this NFL football player they talked about when he came out of college. Well, they said, this guy could catch a BB in the dark. Well, if he can do that, I want a shot of it, right? You know, I want to see a guy catch a BB in the dark. And then I want to show some of the scouts. That's the kind of stuff we're talking about. This, and on top of that, it has 12 stops of dynamic range with YDR and Canon log added. So it has a, similar to the C100 Mark II, you're going to find it be very similar. Here's the big difference with this ME20, and I'm kind of going back and forth between them. But so this one that gets so much sensitivity, the reason it does, it's only 2.26 megapixels, right, compared to the 1DX, but each pixel, of which there are 2.26 million, is 7.5 times larger than a pixel on a 1DX. So the light gathering surface image area has been expanded to attract and gather this light. That's why it can see in the dark so well. I'm going to show you a little film now to bring you up to date on the uses of this camera. This is the ME20. All right, so that's cool, right? So even that film got credits, which I applaud. I applaud our group for giving those guys credit. So it's what I want you to take away from that is how this is a multi-purpose camera. It can go anywhere, can do a lot of stuff. But after we released it, we made that film, of course, to release it. And then we kind of realized that, wait a second, whoa, we didn't really go production heavy, right? All we did was we talked about the industrial uses and that it can see in the dark. But what we actually made here was the first of a series of cameras that we intend to go everywhere, including production. So I went to the crack marketing team and I said, guys, you got to help me out. I need to have some footage that shows filmmakers using this camera. It's not just a camera for the shipyards and the airports and underwater surveillance. So let's look at this.
Very cinematic look.
When I first heard about the M20, it was definitely because of the high ISO. But what actually really excited me about it was the fact that it's the full frame sensor.
Daytime, nighttime, that's what that full frame gets you.
Just like a large telescope, we gather more light. That puts us in a whole new world, magical.
I'm a big believer in being able to sort of step into a scenario, put up a light or two, and start shooting. Having scouted and looked at this location and knowing that there was no light at all, we were getting a camera that could basically see in the dark.
Action!
This ME20 camera, it has qualities which more and more of us are moving towards. And as you increase the ISO of the camera, it takes you into a whole new realm of how to see. I tested this camera shooting ocean whitecaps and seeing the reflection from jets taking off from LAX reflected in the waves rolling across the surface. With your eyes, you just have a sense that, oh, I can see the waves. But when you get to 100,000 with this camera and you open the shutter a little bit and you use a fast lens, suddenly there's a whole new world available to you.
The ME20 became very interesting to me in looking at, can I use this at a higher ISO, be very fast and mobile, put up one, two lights, and actually get something that felt like it was happening as opposed to something that was staged.
This camera really helps the audience feel like you're at the location, you're in the environment.
To be able to put the camera on at 25,000 ISO and just see the sprawl that is LA was fantastic. We ended up shooting a couple shots at 100,000 ISO, essentially wanting to see the sky and see the stars, and having these sort of certain shots where you just felt the universe around you was really, really cool. Being able to frame an actor, but yet see this desert landscape that we're lighting is a massive benefit. It just helps make it feel big.
This camera gave me a unique look where I wanted to feel like environments were huge, but I wanted to get intimate with the characters within the environments.
There were a lot of scenes where we wanted to be very close to our actor physically, but still being able to see a lot of the world around me.
The camera's very small, which allows you to rig it in a lot of different ways.
Suddenly, all those difficult positions are available to us.
You can build it out to exactly what you need it to be. When I was shooting the shootout sequence, it was a lot of fun to actually shoot with it because it was so light and it was so mobile. What I love about the ME20 certainly is I'm able to make it a part of my toolbox and really have it fit to the production model that I've created for myself, as opposed to having to adjust my working method in the way that I want to work to the camera.
So I'm sorry a lot of you guys can't make it to NAB each year. If you'd been there, you could have seen all of these filmmakers. We had them on two different stages presenting and showing their films they'd made with this cameras. A lot of work being done in a very short time, and it can, and the aggressive marketing team that we have can get these cameras in filmmakers' hands. You guys don't be shy to go to these guys that are here in the room today and talk to them about your ideas and your plans and see what you can do. We'd love to see people that have aggressive camera ideas or filmmaking ideas, and we want to help work together to produce the type of images that you keep seeing in these films. And so many of these films are ones that I have personally had some contribution in. So I'm very proud of this work. It's been my 4 years and very, very happy to share all that with you. I need to blow through a lot of this stuff now. I know we're running, the last session went a little long. So let's just look at, recap some of the interesting aspects here. It's in the tradition. This is what you need to take away from the C100 Mark II with higher sensitivity. It has a dual pixel autofocus. We talked about the wide dynamic range, but we added a new resolution, and that's at 59p and 50p. We basically recommend it to be used with the RCV100. We have one in our booth back there. It's a total remote control package for our cameras and lenses, a lot of them. It can perform most of the very important shading functions, including the operation functions on a set. Let's just look at what this camera does. It has infrared ability. You've already seen a couple of images from that. It uses a motorized four filter system, including an IR cut filter. When it's removed, and you get the IR look, or you can also leave it in and it will shoot in infrared in color. It's very impressive. It has two stops of ND in there, two levels of ND. This was another thing from that same article I was making, kind of, you know, having fun with the guy earlier, and then he chimed in a little later. He goes, Canon isn't telling anyone what codec we're using. Well, I just wanted to write him a note on his forum, but I'll just tell him here, you know, we don't use any codecs. This camera doesn't have any internal recording. It's not meant to do that. It's meant to be a very small, lightweight camera. And these are the inputs and the outputs. We have assignable buttons. We have a joystick. We have menu buttons. We have the DC, two levels of power input. We have the 3G SDI connections, the HDMI, and these are the frame rates and resolutions possible. It has a Genlock terminal for using in broadcast, right? And it has this micro SD card that you cannot record in. You can only use for firmware updates. And here's a closer look at the back of the camera to kind of show you what we got there. I want to just emphasize it's compact and lightweight. It's an aluminum body, 1 kilo. It's got this cube design, 4 inches, right? It has the EF cinema mount lock, so you've got a very simple system for moving lenses in and out. And it's works with, and it has this lens terminal connection here, which is so you can remotely control lenses, including the broadcast lenses. The broadcast lenses require a adapter. I got this little disclaimer in there. There's no guarantees, but it's certainly possible, and everyone's using that. We have the EF and the EFS. We have the EF cinema lenses all working with it. Here's a full list of the lenses that are currently supported. We have about, I think, 26 for the ME20 and 30 for the ME200, and that list keeps growing. And just to recap, let's look at the comparisons again between the three cameras. I think that the color sampling down here is, if you do an external recorder, you're going to have the same codec or the same color space, color depth. And the price is obviously a little higher than the C100 Mark II, but this guy is really a lot of money. And so you have to have some real reasons for it. But we see this working in the type of environment it's working in. The money is not the issue. It's seeing and using it in the way it's supposed to be that will be the important factor. Once again, we got one shot AF. I think that's an important feature to note about this camera. There's no dual pixel, but both of these, and this particular, this ME200 includes dual pixel autofocus. It requires a system. Here's kind of the system components, the lenses, the body, the power connector, AC adapters or battery, 12 volt DC battery. Here's the cable, the RCV100 we recommend with it. And a monitor recorder unit is a must, more or less. Then I just want to let you know that there were some positive reviews came out of NAB. You know, after they look at the camera, you start to understand this camera really is useful, right? And this was just one of the comments I pulled out, and this was how we had it built at NAB right here. So that's the ME200 SSH. I'll be happy to answer any questions. I guess we're taking questions at the end, right? Is that kind of the way we want to do it? All right, so keep anything in mind that you want to ask me about that camera. I'll be here all week if we miss today. Here's this new compact servo lens, the CNE 18-80 T44L ISKASS. You're wondering, okay, here he goes with those letters again. What do they mean? Well, I can tell you that the K stands for no extender. The A stands for servo and zoom focus control. Servo zoom and focus control. And the S stands for iris servo. And the final S stands for Super 35 again. So it comes in a couple flavors. We have it in the without this hand grip and then with this optional hand grip. Okay. So anyway, here we go. This is where we kind of came from, right? We know we have this great lineup of cinema, Canon Cine lenses, the Cine Primes, the Zooms, compact Zooms, the Cine Servos. Everyone knows about the tremendous selection of EF lenses. We keep adding to these every day. But we needed something to kind of fit in the middle, right? So we designed this new category of lens to fit right in the middle. And it's not just in the middle figuratively, like it's in the middle of all of these lenses. It's actually also, we're thinking it's going to be right in the middle of the price. That's what we're estimating it to be. So it's a very affordable lens when you think about where we're coming from. It's kind of like, I think about it like a motorcycle, right? You got $2,000 scooters, you got $40,000 Harleys, but you don't just sell two types of motorcycles. You got to have something to cover the line. And this is where this new category is going. This is just the first. They're already working on the second series, but this lens is a true hybrid lens of all of these. It takes the best of the L series. It takes the best of the manual Cine Servo lenses and the Cine Servo zooms. And from the L series, these are the elements that it's borrowing: the dual pixel autofocus, the IS, the AE, the power. It gets power from the mount, the remote controls via the camera, so you can use it with a Wi-Fi, you can control the lens, or the RCV100, and it has these correction functions that we've begun to expect with our L series. From the cinema lenses, we get the par focal characteristics of the lens, very minimal focus breathing. Stepless iris, no longer one-third, one-fourth stops. Now we have a very smooth iris control for this lens. And most importantly, it's 4K, right? And it has a color that's significantly like the cinema lenses. And with beautiful bokeh characteristics from a 9-blade iris. So it has a lot of the good things there. From the Cine Servo, we grab this ENG style grip, right? And we get record on off, we get push auto iris. We get zoom servo control, remote zoom control capability, so we can remote it back to a broadcast controllers or to a truck or whatever we need to do. So let's look at this, though. So why did we pick this focal length? Why this 18 to 80? Well, it's all about trying to keep the lens small, right? And it's also about a compact, lightweight build. We wanted it to have a constant brightness so that it was always a 4. We didn't want it to ramp at all. So lightweight, compact, constant brightness, and it happens to be the focal length that we at Canon have observed that most people use, and that's in cinema production, and especially in handheld production. This is how it kind of fits into our lens lineup. Outstanding optical performance, 4K production, a 3-group lens system, system manages, it minimizes breathing, consistent color balance, identical to EF cinema lenses, and I shot a comparison. I'll show you guys later the comparison I shot with the EF lenses. Consistent throughout the zoom range, right? Constant brightness, very important. So we also have the servo unit incorporated into the lens body for zoom, servo, or manual operations. We have EF mount communication, recording of focal length, stop, lens model on right onto the SD card or the external recorder. The lens receives its power via the camera with all the right from the EF contact, so you don't need an external battery, but it does have a place that you can use an external battery. And you can, because it has a 20-pin connection out, you can use it with controllers for broadcast, and you can use it with as either a focus or a zoom as it comes out with just one cable. We're waiting on third-party manufacturers to jump in and give us a Y adapter that'll split that out and make it into two cables. It supports various shooting styles. Here's just a few of them I'll throw out there. You guys can probably think of a bunch more, but you can see this is the one I find the most interesting kind of here. You can also remote that hand grip down as a right-hand grip and use that for your record start-stop and zoom and one push auto iris. The product concepts without the hand grip, so it's sold like this, right? So this is how you get the lens. Variable speed zoom control, the rocker, it's ideally suited to a lot of production styles, and we see this as being the main way that it will be sold, not with the hand grip, but you're going to want the hand grip, and I'll show you why in a second. Just a couple more interesting things with the without the hand grip. You can easily switch. This switch is just so easy to grab with your thumb. This is the servo variable speed control here. Here, this is kind of the interesting part of the lens to me, the auto iris, manual iris, so you don't even need to, you know, worry about your exposure if you don't want to. Same thing with focus, autofocus, manual focus. It has a slip ring focus guide here, just like the EF lenses, so you can always focus. You can always use the focus. And it's got three levels of image stabilization, which is for a medium, a middle, a low, a medium, and a high, different vibration frequencies, different uses. Here's the product concepts with the hand grip. This is how we see it being used right here. And just to let you know, this ZSG C10, another great name we came up with, but it must mean something. I don't have these letters ready. But it's about $500 US, right? And then with that, you get all these cool little accessories that come with it. It mounts with an Airy Rosette style attachment. It has this 20-pin connection cable to go in to control the zoom and so forth. Here's the cable length. Here's some of those cool little buttons on it and things you can do. You can also flip it around and adjust it, shoot it any way you want to. And that works really well on the exterior hand grip on a rig unit. Here's the an illustration of all the functions that I could think of on the lens that are interesting. I think that it has these 77 millimeter screw-in front filters, and you can clamp on with an 84 millimeter box. Just a recap, and here's a close-up of that side of the working mechanism of the lens. Here's the, it has this redundant zoom control underneath, so if you don't have the hand grip on there, you actually have focused zoom servo wide tele switch right here. Here's your 20 pin in, here's your DC power in back here, see it? And so that's kind of the layout of the lens. Plus it has this easy to get to, super easy to get to, flange back adjustment, back focus adjustment. These are the parts that come with the CSG C10. It's a hand grip, a support post. We recommend that you use it with 15 millimeter rod, so you need a support. And these are basically those items. Here's the specs on it. Everyone loves specs, right? Let's look at it. Very lightweight. This is what I want to call your attention to. 2.65 pounds. It's like a 70 to 200. It feels like that in your hand. It's so lightweight, but it's super good looking. It's a very quality lens, and the coatings are a little different, and you'll see the differences in a second. All right, so there, that was the specs about the lens. That's basically all the information. Now I'll show you some footage I shot down in the studio at Canon. This is in the basement. We set up a little studio and we did a couple of shots. So they were shot in 4K. I'm sorry to say that I don't have the ability to play 4K. We don't really have the computer power with us. So I've down-resed everything to HD. There's old music, guys. Little sound. Little twinkle sound. Twinkle lights, twinkly sound on the keyboard. All right. Now, as I warned you, I was going to show you this next video, which is the close-ups and comparisons between the 18 to 80 and the EF 24 to 105, which I thought would be of interest. So I would shoot a shot, and then I'd put the other lens on and shoot a shot, and then I just wanted to see what that looked like later. Here we go. This is, by the way, all shot with the new Canon Log 2 that we'll talk about in just a few minutes. I was also testing that. The exteriors you saw a second ago in the Manhattan area were Canon Log 3. A little bit different colors. This area of the face, I noticed a lot of sharpness variations in here. The eyelashes were much more brilliant. Here's some characteristics of the bokeh. What do you guys say? Beautiful bokeh. Really, it's so round and perfect. It looks very, very pretty, and it goes out of focus so nicely like that. This is the 24-105. It came out a little darker. I didn't pump it up. I didn't do much grading. I just kind of put them on with a LUT. This is what we got. This is the LUT I used down here. And just one more comparison, and we'll move on. This is the comparison of the flare. Soft flares, it was very nice. I love the, this was at an 8. I was just trying to get a few of the fingers of light there, the star effect. A little bit, you can tell the coding differences there a little bit with the EF 24 to 105. Anyway, I thought this won the challenge. It wasn't supposed to be that. It was just my own information, but I found it to be very interesting. All right, let's move on. This is the more important news. These are the firmware updates from NAB 2016 I want to share with you. This will especially affect C300 Mark II users, C100 Mark II users, and some other cameras. We'll go through a few of them. This is generally the list of candidates and the things that we're doing. And this is their release dates for the cameras. Here's the cameras, and that's the corrections, and these are the or the updates, I should call them. All right, this is a camera that you guys really don't use much, and I meant to take this out of the presentation. In fact, I told Yuri that I would, but I'm going to skip through this a little bit. This is interesting only for American football right now, where these updates were done to make this available to football teams who now use these IBM Surface Pros on the sideline and in practice situations. I think they get through it very well. So they wanted this very small 8 megabits file size to pass around instantaneously. We've added highlight priority. This is to make it match with the XF200 and 205. We've added signal to noise priority, where you can actually kind of give up a little bit of resolution for a better, less noisy image. And you can have a Chinese menu brought to your house that you can order from. That's about it. Then this is the XC10. I don't know, we introduced this camera last year about this time. We had one here. We've added MP4 recording and at these limited frame rates, but it's we thought that would be a nice addition. The MP4, this is exactly its characteristics here. And we've also improved the AF, and we have 3 levels of autofocus in this camera, so you can select them, but it's like almost twice as fast, so we think it's a little better. And we've added some additional shutter speeds, so it's to correct some of the, they left out a couple, like 48 and 50, they added more in there to make it more friendly for whatever you like to use, right? Let's look at the ME20. This is the camera we've been talking about. This thing right up here, this 12-pin Cine servo serial communication, was not active when we released it, and that's what works with the 17 to 120 Cine servo. We've added these aspect ratio displays for your markers, so you can use it in cinematic productions, and we've added the x8 teleconverter. So now you, whatever lens you've got on there, you can have 8 times that in a digital teleconversion. And we've been able to remove the on-screen displays, which were kind of annoying. You had to know how to do it on your external recorder, and now it's possible to do it with a simple command. And we've added this ability to remove the slow shutter function, which when you had it in auto, what it would do is it would do anything it could to make the scene brighter. So it would, you know, lower your shutter and lower your iris and raise the ISO. And that result, there was not a great cinematic option. So now we've got control of the shutter, which we give it back to the cinematographer, which is kind of important. And we've added more lenses for its support. So let's move on to the C100 Mark II. These are the firmware updates for it. What we've done basically is we've added these lenses in this lens, 17-120, and here's the 1880 I was talking about earlier. All of the autofocus features are in there, right? So everything you're used to using, the C100, of course, doesn't have as robust autofocus features as the C300 Mark II, but we're all familiar with them. And we've also added this support for this lens, everything that you see there except dual pixel autofocus for the 50 to 1000, right? And this is kind of a cool new feature. The joystick now can be used for zooming. So you go tight, wide, and it's very cool, and it has 16 speeds. It works great. We have the new firmware installed on the C300 Mark II back there, and it has the same feature, so you could check it out back there. And now the built-in microphone can be turned off, so you can say whatever you want to about your producer on your next job when you're standing behind the camera. I think it's a great feature. Sometimes we're also, you know, we've been breaking off the ends of headsets and putting them in there. That seems to stop them too. So until you get the update, I gave you a tip. We have the C300 Mark II firmware updates. These are the very same ones that you saw with the C100 Mark II, with the lenses, the joystick. And I don't think they took the microphone on off. I don't think they gave it to that camera yet. So we're going to have to talk to the guys in Japan and get them to be able to turn that microphone off. But now we have the joystick, and that's the one you can check out in the back. We've also qualified, this is the new word now, with ACES. You guys need to get on board with ACES, at least educate yourself about it. Universal Pictures became the first major Hollywood studio to adopt a complete ACES workflow. That happened 2 weeks ago or so. So now we support ACES 1.0, and the word is qualified. They're not certifying anything, but if your equipment meets certain standards and quality, they will qualify you. Of course, that's the Academy of Motion Picture Sciences who has taken on this as their project. Encapsulating every color space into one color space. That's what this is all about. So that every grain, every film stock you ever shot, every digital camera you ever shoot will be encompassed in this and can work in the same post environment. That's a very important new feature. The C300 Mark II also, someone posted this video on YouTube a few months ago, and we said, well, look, we're doing this new firmware, let's throw that in there. This is a kind of a hard effect to create, and no one likes this. So they've done some pixel adjustments on the sensor. They're going to get rid of it. It's very hard to create. And this is the cool thing. I actually talked about this a year ago in a YouTube video I made when we launched the camera. And then when the camera came out, it didn't have it, and I was freaking out because I'd put it in my video, and it was too late to take the video down from YouTube. I already had like 100,000 hits or something. So they said, oh, don't worry, we'll put it in there someday. And I kept getting all these emails and letters like, what happened? You said it could be in there. So I've been telling all these guys, oh, man, hang in there. I think it'll come. So, yay, I'm happy it's there. You know, I didn't lie. This is, I think, a gigantic improvement because now you can use all of these Cinema Primes with the focus guide. So if you don't know what the focus guide is, basically, you know, it shows you with these animations to either, hey, you've gone too far, come back, you know, or go back, you know. So it's got like, once you learn the animation trigger there, you hit this green box, your 4K images are bright and crystal clear. I guarantee it works. It's so cool. All right, now here's the other thing that a bunch of people asked for. I don't know if you guys used the camera and asked for it yourself, but everyone else I seemed to talk to said, oh my God, you know, the C300 had magnified during record. Why did you take it out? Well, we had to ask the same question, and they responded. They put it back in. We consider this to be a major USA win anyway, because everyone loves it. And you just lose a couple things like face recognition and stuff. You do have to give up something to use it, but it's there. It's a selectable event in the menu. Let's talk about these things. Now, here's some of the stuff that image improvements, noise, streaking, smearing, banning. I think we've all, since seeing this camera come out, we've seen it take a lot of beating on the internet. But that's, I just want you to know that a lot of that was just talk and bluster. Some of it, though, opened a lot of eyes, especially to our engineers, and said, well, you know, if it bothers them, let's try to fix it, right? So I think that's the right attitude. And we also have improved, so now we've improved streaking, we've reduced it, and we've improved the noise in the signal. And I'll show you some examples how we did that, and also the added a new log curve, a new gamma curve, Canon Log 3. I think you'll find it very useful. So we're going to find out what it is, and we're going to see some plots, some graph charts to show you how they compare, and we'll look at that. And I have some footage. So we have two more movies, man, that'll hopefully get you back up from my PowerPoint. And so to remind you now, Canon Log 2, here's, you know, we did all these, when it came out, we said, yeah, 15 stops, we're good with that, right? And it has 200% highlight protection at ISO 100, 1600% at 800 and above. And that is throughout this dynamic range chart. But this is, and I'm gonna show you the chart in a second, but remember, 15 stops of latitude means you have some responsibilities too. This is designed for high-end production. It's designed for playing on the right level with the other cameras, right? This was not meant to be a pick up and shoot and worry about, you know, you don't have to worry about post. No, you have to actually take this into post and make it work for you. And that's the important ingredient I really want to talk about. As you recall or may remember, I'm going to remind you now, when we went from the 12 stops on the C300 to the 15 stops in the C300 Mark II, we added two stops above middle gray. We added one stop above middle gray, and we put two stops in here, in the bottom. And that was to support HDR production. And if you were at NAB 2016 this year, one of the biggest things that everyone talked about the entire time was HDR. High dynamic range television is here, guys, and we need to be on board with it. And that's going to mean in post now that after you do your color correct, you're going to need to do a second trim pass. And you're going to be about 80% there with your original color correct, but you're going to have to now come back and do an HDR for archival purposes, and you might as well do it while you're doing your masters. But it's an important step. So we put this 15 stops built like it is to benefit HDR delivery. But right after the camera was announced, raise your hand if this actually rings a bell to you. This guy, Sebastian Wober. Anyway, it got a lot of attention in the United States, and especially with the camera. We went through a lot of talk with this guy, and he's a very intelligent, articulate man, but, you know, it really came down to testing methods, you know, and testing, you know, like, what do you call usable stops, right? So he had this thing about, well, it only shows these usable stops here, you know, and maybe this contrast could be better, and you guys could see this a little better, but, you know, he said, I would only shoot it to here, and that's just these 13 stops or something. And he added some other cameras in there to show the differences, and then he raised the gamma. So he lifted the gamma, and would you mind turning the house lights down? Can you turn the house lights down for a second? Because it's important to show a little bit of this. Thank you. Yeah. All right, so we can see a little better. So the phenomena that was called smear or streaking is this item here, which is the exact replication of this box, right? So this became something that is statistically, you never really line up these shots too much unless you're like shooting a remake of the Cabinet of Dr. Caligari or something, right? But it was raised, the issue was raised. What is up with that? Well, here's what the deal is. So every sensor, every CMOS sensor has some form of this banding. It's just that there are different ways of processing the image. And we were exposed a little bit. I guess Sony was slightly exposed in it. They seemed to have a little more issues in one area than we did. And, you know, but I mean, it was all kind of like, we can fix it in post. This was truly a case of we can fix it in post. But that wasn't enough. And it came down to our testing methods. And so this next slide shows you what our testing methods were. And this is how we test dynamic range at Canon, right? We use this oscilloscope, a Leader 5770 to be exact. And what you're seeing here, starting with this stop, that's one stop, two stop, three stop, all the way down to this right here being the 15th stop, right? So you count them out and go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. You can measure that in voltage. And you can't read it, I'm sorry, man, but this is the best graphic I could get. But it's in millivolts. And noise level is this indication. This is noise. This is video noise, this big white band right here. And those stops are sitting right down there in the noise. So you have to decide as filmmakers, how much noise can you tolerate in your post-production process? Because it's not a matter of if it's going to be there forever. It's a matter of how hard you may have to work to get rid of it in the very dark areas of very special scenes that you line up and shoot. This is a very important consideration in cinematography. We gave you a couple extra stops in the bottom of the dynamic range chart. You have to deal with it. However, it wasn't enough. So we said, look, they had a problem with it. Let's talk about it. What can we do? Let's answer this guy. Let's not sit behind the internet and go, we don't hear you. No, let's see what we can do. So the first thing we did is we attacked this noise zone down here. And just to see if you can read this, these are just like 0.1 and 0.3 millivolts apart. The noise floor is 0.31 millivolts on a 700 millivolt scale, where 700 is complete white. And the noise floor, this is just 0.34, the noise floor is 0.31. So the first thing we did was lower that noise floor. So we've refined the imaging, we've done processing. This was the concept, reduce the noise in the dark areas. Do not mess with the mid to highlights. We love that area, it looks great. Let's keep the curve, don't change Canalog 2. Let's improve the signal processing. So we reduced the noise in the dark areas by readjusting a device control and optimizing signal processing. So it's all math, it's an algorithm. It's an algorithm that looks at the dark areas of the sensor, of the image, of the zeros and ones that come out through the digital processor and readjust them. So we've reduced the dark noise level approximately 6 dB. And this is how we measured these slides I'm about to show you. So here's just a couple of instances. So here we were, this is how it was. Now this is lifted, this is not like every shot. You have to want to see into this shot. So you have to like put this on in your DaVinci Resolve, crank up the gamma, lift gamma gain. You have to kind of want to see this, but it's there. And it's a very, very small measurement. It's like, I wish I had the exact number in my head, I think it's like 0.01 millivolts of amperage. It's nothing, it's very insignificant. But here's what we did. This is now what it looks like in the new improved Canalog 2. It's a major gig, right? That was a big diff. Before, after. It's still a little present, but I'm telling you, we could get rid of it before. Now you're going to have no problem getting rid of it. So I think that was a gigantic victory for the engineers. And then, so here's this streaking situation again. Can you lower the lights one more time, please? The house lights just come down. Because I want to show you, okay, so here we were before. And this is kind of where we are after. It's about a 4 dB improvement. So, and the streaking improvement was in all the log modes, including the new ones. So we reduced the streaking at low ISOs. We changed the CMOS sensor control. We improved the streaking by 4 dB. We adapted this method to two ISOs, 800 and 1600. And, oh, by the way, there's also a lot of good press about the C300 Mark II. It's a magnificent camera, you guys. And it has recently been approved by the European Broadcast Union. And this tech assessment, if you ever had a chance to read EBU Tech 335, I recommend if you own the camera, you're going to want to know it, because this guy goes into 6 or 8 pages of immense detail about this camera, and he has recommendations, and he makes exact references to things that will be on your mind. So I recommend it. It's a great article. We're very happy the camera's been accepted, and it tends to just keep getting accepted more and more. So here we go, New Log 3. This is kind of the, we're wrapping it up now, guys. I'm gonna go through this pretty quick. So stick with me. We have 14 stops in Canon Log 3. This is designed for most of us, right? Designed for the middle end users who are not using extensive post-production processing or finishing, and you know, like broadcasting, maybe documentaries, something like that, right? Here's what Canon Log 3 looks like on a chart. This is Canon Log 2. We're comparing it with Canon Log. This was our feedback from users. They didn't want the streaking, they didn't want noise. You know, that was all the stuff we just talked about. So let's make a new log. Let's start the angle more gentle, more like Canon Log. This looks a lot like original Canon Log. The brightness will be a little higher than Canon Log. And we're going to improve the noise, and we're going to have a very good dynamic range, and we're going to remove the needless headroom. So no more stopping at 92. We're going to take it all the way to 100 and stretch out the curve. So this is an example of it laid in with Canon Log, Canon Log 2 and Canon Log 3, Canon Log 3 being this pink one. See, it starts a little higher off of the noise floor. The noise floor would be down here. In fact, the noise floor all happens kind of below 6 IRE, right? The noise in the image is down in here. And so if you're at 6 IRE, that's going to be somewhere around where Canon Log 2 used to be. This is above the noise floor. So it's just like Canon Log. It's starting at exactly the same place. Just to give you an idea how this stuff works, the curve looks very similar, but it starts getting a little flatter and extends the dynamic range out to 14 plus stops, right? So this is what Canon Log 3 looks like in that very same comparison that you saw earlier. And this is what all three of them kind of look like together with the current firmware. And this is the current, the current firmware. This is the new firmware in the middle. And this is worthless probably to you guys, because who's going to see this? Like, there's some noise in there. Hey, noise everywhere. No, there's not. It's three black boxes on a white screen. I apologize. But come by. If you want to see more of it, I'll show you big time. All right. So wrapping that up, I just want you to see this one more time. You can see where middle gray sits. Exactly the same as original Canon Log. Here's your black. Here's your whites. And let's compare those to a couple of well-known other curves. Here's S-Log 2 and 3 laid in. Very similar looking, again, to S-Log 3. I mean, S-Log 2, excuse me. Here it is with the Log C from the ARRI. See, Canon Log 2 is almost identical to Log C. And here's a comparison of all of them added together. So, I have another video. I'm just going to play it. It has no sound. I'm just going to talk you through it. It has a little sound, but it's not important. Can you lower the house lights? This is a movie that shows the Canon Log 2 original and then Canon Log 2 new. And then I have Canon Log 2 versus Canon Log 3. So, here's what this looks like. That's the guy working in the background. We'll take him down for this, okay? This is my good friend, John Carr. He's a colorist, and he's a cinematographer, filmmaker like yourselves. We're looking at noise in the dark areas. This is Canon Log 2, the new improved version of Canon Log 2. These are ungraded log images. Here's what Canon Log 3 looks like. Very same shot, very same moment, right? Canon Log 2 new, and then let's go to, you'll see the difference, see the blacks being just a little steeper curve, so you got a little more contrast in the image, not as flat. Highlights are still protected. This is Utah, Salt Lake City. Canon Log 3, and I think that this is the last image of this. So I just wanted you to see kind of what 2 and 3 are different on a log, you can see. And then, how am I doing for time? Do I need to wrap this up? I have one thing I would like to show you guys. It's a big tip. So I think it's important enough that I'd show you whether we have time or not. And what it is, I'm just going to show you a couple of shots in DaVinci Resolve real quick. And I want to show you mainly, I want to just point you to one important feature that I think is, and it's this here, clip attributes. I'm sure yours is in Portuguese, but this is how we get it. This is a free software. This is the same one you get free. Clip attributes. DaVinci does not ingest the footage correctly. It does it in video levels. So you need to open up your clip attributes and change the video levels to data levels. If you don't, you're robbing yourself of some extra highlight protection. I think that's a very important factor. And then I'll just give you this real quick little, nothing else. Oh man, maybe nothing else, that's stuck. Nope. Sorry, it bit the dust, man. Probably got tired of me talking, but regardless, I can't go on. And I only had one more film, but it was the best film. I saved it for the last. I'll describe it to you later. Anyway, house lights up, please. Any questions at all about anything we just talked about? I'm kind of stuck on this page. I can't go back and do my wrap-up slide, which was beautiful. It had a thank you and any questions and the end and all. So anybody have anything you want to ask me now?
I have a question.
In the back.
Tá pegando? Tá. Hi. Good afternoon.
Hello.
Thank you for coming.
Thanks.
As we've seen, the results are incredible, and I don't know how much we can go further. And my question is, this is the newest launch, I suppose, and what can we expect from the next one?
Launch?
Yeah, because are you guys going to keep thinking about new cameras or lenses or new medias? Because I don't know, I think this is just beyond great, and I don't
you
know
think,
how.
You do think it's great or you don't think it's great?
I think it's great.
I think it's amazing.
Yes.
You know, I'm proud of our engineers, and there's been times when we've just like you guys have cussed them out, like, what are they doing over there? You know, this is get to work. But they have come through so big. I mean, these image improvements are just gorgeous, guys. I have a pet project of my own that I was not able to get into this firmware update. And I think that I've been somewhat assured that it will be in the fall. I'm not announcing anything out of line because I saw it accidentally released. And that is the addition of adding audio to the 2K crop mode in the C300 Mark II, so you'll be able to use your B4 mount broadcast lenses. I think that will be huge, and Sony already does that to a certain extent with their FS7, FS5, and they have the ability to shoot with the broadcast lenses and record sound. I think that's very important. I hope they put it in there. I'm pushing it very hard because I think it opens up all of our Canon broadcast lenses to being used in with our cinema production cameras, so why not, right? I think it's a no-brainer. Another question? Oh, right here.
Oh, hello.
Hi.
Good afternoon. My question is about the C-Log 3, about exposure, because most logs out there, when I use them, I normally shoot with one stop above what my light meter gives me. And, well, in a normal condition, like outside, 9 a.m., shooting with C-Log 3, what would you recommend?
Yeah, so I've heard this from other people, and in fact, we have recommended that in certain situations as well. So you're not out of line to doing this. Here's what I emphatically recommend you start with. And when you have your setup done, you get an 18% gray card. And you put it where the interview's face is going to be. and you look at that and you read it with your spot meter, or you look at the waveform monitor, and you put it at 39.2, 40, right? Just a straight line across there. Fill the frame with your gray card and put it at 40. And if you're shooting Canalog 1, put it at 32, so just above the 30 line. Start there. Put a LUT on the display, on your external monitor. Then shade to eye. If you want to go up a full stop, do. But to set your light meter a full stop above your ISO rating on your camera is automatically starting with kind of misinformation. You're giving yourself you're giving the internet too much credibility. The reason I showed you those slides a second ago with the black at 39.2 and 39.8 is those are go-to positions. Now, a lot of people say, oh, I'm better at 40 and 45. Fine, so if your stuff's a little hot in the sky, you like it that way, right? Or, I'm just saying, these things want to be dark, and then open them up with a LUT, look at it, paint to eye. These LUTs are very easy to work with. That was the next part of my demonstration before my computer crashed. We have tons of LUTs on the internet. You can use them in your displays, like the Convergent Design 7Q has them. They have the Canalog LUTs loaded. You can load new LUTs into them. I recommend you work with LUTs. Make a CDL, do an ASC CDL from the set, create one there, and take it to your post. This is what I shot on the set. I loved it, I saved it, I brought it to the job. That's my recommendation, stick with that gray level. And don't let the whites go crazy. Mm-hmm. Save your whites, Use common sense with that, but I want you to stop doing that. I've stopped doing that. I tried it because the internet said, try it, yeah, you'll love it. And I was like, oh no, it's messing me up. I want to go back to what I know. And so stick with what you know. Yes, up here in the middle here, this guy's had his hand up. I'm really fortunate I get to shoot with these cameras a lot. And even for my kid's high school play, his high school musical, I took 5 Canon cameras out by myself. I put 2 side by side, and I left one as a lockdown wide, and I followed the action with another one. And then I mounted one on one wing, one on the other wing, and one in the balcony. All 5 different cameras, right? And then I cut my son's high school musical, which is a charity event for me, just so I know stuff like this. Because this isn't just interesting to you because you're making a living. It's the kind of stuff I need to tell you correctly about all these cameras. Even the cameras you go, I'd never use that camera. No, I used it on the high school musical. So I'm sorry, go ahead.
Hey, Brent, how you doing?
Good, man.
First of all, I'd like to thank you for coming. And I've learned several new solutions Canon is offering. But my question actually is on the EOS line.
Okay.
Actually, I know this is a cinematography convention, so most people here are cinematographers, but there are lots of documentary shooters and other people that would like solutions in the EOS line with cinema camera features. Do Canon have any plans on bringing flat profiles or higher resolutions to EOS cameras?
To the DSLRs?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is interesting, and it's a good question because it comes right on the heels of the launch of the 1DX Mark II. It's a perfect camera. It's a perfect camera. It's everything we wanted it to be, except they left out Canon Log. It's like, wait, we had the 1DC, we loved it, it was perfect, we love that camera, we want to use it. That's the most perfect camera we've made, I'm telling you, in terms of the EOS line, right? That is a killer camera, but we left out Canon Log. Now, have they heard it once? Have they heard it 10 times or 100 times? I don't ever miss an opportunity to bend the ear of any of those designers, and they come over to New York and talk to us. So I have their ear, and I make it known on a daily basis what you guys want. So if there are improvements that you want, like a flat profile, like in the meantime, before we get Canon Log installed on the 1DX Mark II, we're talking with Technicolor. And we want Technicolor to produce what they did for the 5D Mark II, the cine-style flat image. So we have something you guys can grade immediately. This is important to us as well. But having used the 1DX Mark II, don't let that scare you. That camera's a bad boy. And you're going to want to shoot with it, and you need to get a hold of one soon and learn how to use it. Because, there's not much to it. It's just, where do I want the focus? Where do I want the, you know, it's just touch every, it's just incredibly cool. But they left out Canon Log.
Actually, 1DX is a great camera, but price-wise, I'd say that lots of people would like a 5D3 price tag on some, like a 1DX Mini or something in the middle, in between. I don't know, you guys mostly shoot with C100s, but actually, my productions, documentaries, and independent shooting, I'd love to have something in between. Okay.
Some camera in between. Well, you see the lens? Did you see where the lens came? Was that not right in between? So we can only hope that they're hearing you and that these are the kind of comments that I'll definitely pass along. I know this. I think the C100 Mark II did an excellent job improving on its C100. I think the C300 Mark II did, but in improving on the C300, I can't wait to see where the C500 improvement ends up, because I think that, the possibilities are massive there, right, for that camera and what we're gonna do with that. So there's the improvements that you want, I wanna hear about. And so I want you to take my email address and send them to me, because I do pass this stuff on. We have a direct conduit to Japan, and I can go over there and talk to him. And then or I can, when he doesn't talk back, I can send him an email reminding him. So I make these things happen. And I'm a cinematographer. I'm like, you guys, I understand this. This isn't like, oh man, another guy complaining. Any more questions? I'm trying to load up again just so I can show you this one tip I didn't get to show you, which I thought was worthwhile. Does anybody use Resolve 12? Do you guys use it? Does anybody color correct with it? Nobody? Resolve? DaVinci? DaVinci Resolve 12? Good. Got a hand. Do you use Premiere as well?
Yes.
The Lumetri?
Yes.
Color program?
The Lumetri.
Which one do you prefer?
Resolve.
Me too. Well, I'm learning it. So this is me in my infant stages with it. I've been afraid of it, but I've learned how easy it is, and now I'm crazy about it, and I don't want to color in Premiere anymore. I want to go back and forth between the two, which is basically what I'm doing. So I can be back here real quick here. Hang on. So the guy, John Carr, that I was telling you about that shot those A-B comparisons out in Utah, he also sent me a film, and I think it's important you see it because it is what this new Canon Log 2 looks like. It is how pretty it looks, and it would be wrong of me to just go, oh, okay, I wish you'd seen it. And I want you to see it because it's very important to me to show you what we did, how we got things right. And all right, let's try this again. Thank you. And so I showed you about the clip attributes, which are important. Now I want to flip over to the color screen, and I want to show you how John works. Now John is, here's two different ways of coloring in DaVinci. Both are super easy cool. So this is the Canon Log 2. This is Canon Log 2, this is Canon Log 3. These are the shots that you saw a second ago. They just happen to now be in this format. So let me just start with this shot here. What John does is he works with these curves, and he basically just makes a simple little S curve like this. And that's kind of where he starts. To get into the game, he'll just make a little S curve like that. My resolution has changed. I'm not going to, unfortunately. The other way of color correcting is this. So you go to Canon website, you download the 3D LUT. We have tons of them there. Don't be shy, they're free. And so you go in there and you find, in this case, I'm going to put the Canon Log 2. Remember, nothing's changed with Canon Log 2 except image improvements. And I'm just going to drop the LUT on it. And that is with the 3D LUT. So now I've got the 3D LUT on. the Canon C300 Mark II, and that's a good way to start. Then with that, and just to show you what that looks like, so that kind of added a little color and a little boost and contrast and all. And then with that, if you can do a little bit of a color boost, you can also go back into your curves, which is not a bad idea, and just put some simple corrections on it to really kind of sweeten that shot up. And here's just a quick and down and dirty one. But so that's the combination. Just, we have the LUTs available. I wanted you to see where they are. And then because it's Canalog 2, you go and you add saturation, you put color boost, very simple controls in this program. And so make a simple S curve like this down here. Go as far as you want. You know, make, of course, whatever your tolerance is for pain. You go, you can crank it up, bring, you know, keep your highlights, work in your midtones, drag this down. These curves in this one, it makes it so simple. But I recommend starting with the 3D LUT and then working with your curves and then adding the saturation in. Now, let's go back out, and I want to continue the final project, the final element of this entire operation was this movie. All right, so I'm ready for you to show the PowerPoint. This is John, and so I told him I'd give him credit. I did, so right, hey, when you see John, tell him, you know, Brent was talking you up, man. And this has sound. That's it. Thank you, guys. Thanks so much for coming today. Thanks a lot. Thank you. You bet.
Bom, gente, obrigado. Queria agradecer o Brent, queria agradecer o Canon por mais um ano estar junto com a gente, tê-los com a gente é muito importante para que esse evento funcione, certo? Então, queria mais uma vez agradecer a Roberta, agradecer ao Brent e a todos da Canon. Vamos sortear os dois livros que eu prometi. Espero que todos estejam com o papelzinho na mão. Só para quem estiver aqui dentro, tem gente voltando para poder ver. O primeiro livro vai para o número 133. Está aqui? Passou. Então vai para o número 120. Está aqui? Passou. Vai para o número 91. Não? 95. Gente, não saiu tanta pessoa da sala assim, não. Uma coisa errada aí. Tô com número, a mesa é 3, né? A mesa é 3? É. 68. Pronto, achamos um vencedor. Agora vamos para o próximo livro. Eu falei qual que é o livro, né? O Fernando Duarte. Que é esse aqui, O Mestre da Luz Tropical, um livro maravilhoso. O outro é 105. Não? Só um segundo. 56. Não? Vou tentar mais dois, hein? Opa, pronto. Bom, gente, obrigado. A próxima mesa é uma mesa de som. Mais uma vez, obrigado ao Brent e a Canon. Lembrando que hoje às 8 horas teremos, no fim da próxima mesa, teremos um churrasco aí do lado de fora.